Let's start with a payrolls report. A slight disappointment, but I just wonder whether we've got to start getting used to numbers well south of 200K. What are your thoughts?
So, Jonathan, thanks for having me. No, look, I don't think we should get used to numbers below 200K. I think what we're seeing here is a continuation of a trend that we've seen in the retail industry, and that's something, you know, that we've got to get used to. You know, had we had a traditional in-store retail Christmas, and we would have added the traditional 20 or 30,000 jobs in-store retail versus losing 20,000 jobs in retail for the month, we would have had a 200,000 number again. So if you really, that's the one number in here that I think a lot of people missed. You obviously saw some numbers come back in the transportation sector and the driving sector. You heard from some of the transportation logistics companies that they couldn't hire enough people. They actually had managers out delivering and driving trucks because they couldn't put people on fast enough. But no, we see the economy continuously growing and continuously adding jobs on. And remember, tax reform is now 5 days old, and the input that that's going to have into the economy is just starting, just barely starting to have an effect.
Well, Gary, let's talk about the initial reaction of corporate America to the tax cut. The tax cut is permanent, but what I'm seeing is companies to choose to pay one-off bonuses. Are you disappointed by that, that they take a permanent tax cut and just give a one-off bonus?
Look, I don't think that's completely true. I think companies have chosen to do a lot of different things. You did see a lot of companies raise minimum wages up to $15.50 an hour for their lowest wage workers, which is exactly what we wanted to see. Those changes in the minimum wage workers in these companies are permanent changes to the wage system. As the economy continues to grow and as the labor force continues to tighten, remember, unemployment rate is still 4.1%. It's 17-year lows. We are going to see real wage pressure in here. I've been telling you for the last year that the one disappointing number that we see month after month after month is we saw wage growth of 2.5% against CPI of 2.2. So you see a real wage growth in here at 0.3%. That's just not good enough. And we are committed to get real wage growth in this country. And we do believe you will see it over the course of the next year or two.
And to be fair, Gary, you've owned that, but I wonder whether you support the following thing. New York and California are looking to shield their residents from the loss of state and local tax deductions. If they can do that, is that something actually your administration would support?
Look, I've read the articles of what they're trying to do. I mean, I understand what they're trying to do for their cities and their states and their taxpayers. We at the federal government still have to collect revenue. So we're going to have to evaluate what decisions they make in terms of what it does for overall collections at the federal level in the federal tax system.
So what would happen, Gary, if they were able to do that? Would that put you in a little bit of a troublesome spot where you'd have to actually think about where you could raise revenue elsewhere?
Look, you know, we'll deal with it when we have to. Hopefully, we'll grow the economy fast enough that the tax revenues will exceed everyone's expectation based on economic growth. That would be the ultimate answer. That's the answer that we're looking for. We're looking for capital reinvestment. We're looking for businesses to return to America. We're looking for people to spend money and hire people so we can tax a broader economy. That's the right answer for every American, to grow jobs at every level, to grow incomes at every level, and tax more of the economy at a lower rate.
Gary, that would be beautiful, of course, if growth paid for all of this. I caught up with the former Treasury Secretary Jack Lew earlier in the week. He thinks actually the United States runs the risk of going broke. That is a pretty dramatic statement. What do you say back to it?
Look, what I say back to him is they had their chance of running the economy. And when they ran it during the Obama administration, I think they added trillions upon trillions of dollars of debt.
Yeah.
We come in with $20 trillion of debt. You're going to have to judge us on what we do. We're pretty optimistic what we can do here.
Well, the President of the United States would like us to judge us on the market reaction. The Dow through 25,000, celebrating that. Gary, would you caution the President to be a little bit careful at these kind of levels of owning the upside? Are you prepared to own the downside as well?
Look, I was just listening to Bob Dahl. Hi, Bob. How are you? And I agree with everything he was saying. If you look at what's going on in the stock market is a reflection of what is going on in the global economies, what companies are doing from an earnings perspective.
Yeah.
And again, I'm not sure people really understand the effect of tax reform in the stock market. And we have yet to see the capital expenditure that's going to come through for 5 years of expensing. I think the stock market and some other pretty famous investors over the last 24, 48 hours have agreed with us that the stock market is not expensive right now.
Gary, let's make some news. When can I find out who the next vice chair of the Federal Reserve is going to be? Do I get it before the end of the month?
Possibly, but I wouldn't bet on it.
What about market deregulation for the banks, the financials? When are we going to take some concrete steps? Is it a story of less regulation or a story of no more regulation?
We are making enormous progress on a bipartisan basis on bank deregulation. We've got a bill in the Senate that has bipartisan support to really change the regulatory environment for the vast, vast majority of banks in the United States.
Yeah.
And that is going to see floor time, hopefully in January, and we can get that bill through Congress in the first quarter of this year, which is going to really free up, you know, the vast majority of banks in the United States to get back to their core business and serving their communities and serving their customers.
Gary, my Bloomberg Radio co-anchor Tom Keene and myself were having a conversation a little bit earlier about confidence on Wall Street, and we thought about the current battle between the President of the United States and Mr. Bannon. Is confidence being lost at this point? You talked to me about how difficult it is to work in the White House currently. The perception is there's a lot of drama to kick off 2018. What's the reality, Gary?
The reality is the White House is operating smoothly. Everything's going well. Look at what we just accomplished. Let's look at the facts. We just signed literally the last working day in the White House of last year. It's less than 2 weeks ago. We just signed major tax reform simplification, something that has not been done for 31 years. We got that done in the White House with the president's leadership.
Yeah.
Think about that. That tells you how the White House is operating. We're now working aggressively on our new plan for this year. We've got a big meeting at Camp David this weekend with the legislative leaders where we're going to map out our legislative plan for 2018. I think we're working quite effectively and efficiently.
Hey, Gary, just to wrap things up, a lot of we in that last statement, and there was a lot of people on Wall Street that expected you to kind of like fade away and disappear after the tax bill got signed, sealed, delivered. Is it going to be we for a long, long time? Are you sticking with this for the long run down in Washington, D.C.?
Look, there's a lot to be done on the economic agenda. President Trump has a very strong view on how we can drive this economy, and I'm happy to be proud of his economic plan.
Is that a yes then, Gary? You're sticking with it?
I'm happy to be part of his economic agenda.